would stand and help us sing 57 Amazing Grace. This was requested by our two smallest choir members, so.
Maybe that'll work. Well, good evening again, and I thank the Lord for Ernie asking me to come out and this afternoon and share a little something with you. I always feel unworthy to do so, but it's always a blessing to me to be able to study a little bit and be able to give you something that the Lord has given me that allows me to strengthen my faith a little bit and to let me know that we are serving a God that's dead, and we're not serving a God that is hid somewhere. We know as believers He lives in us through the Holy Spirit. But Ernie called me yesterday and said that he was wanting to spend some time with his family, and so I told him that I would do my best to fill in. So y'all pray for me tonight. There's just one scripture that I want to read, and we'll talk a little bit about it. I might read some other scriptures included in what I've the Lord's laid on my heart tonight. But if you'll turn to Ezekiel 33:11. I'm going to talk a little bit tonight about judgment and God's judgment. But before judgment comes, we'll read in Ezekiel 33:11 and what God says about that. And He says, "Say unto them, as I live, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn you from your evil ways, for why will ye die, O house of Israel?" Blessed is the reading of God's word there, that you may be seated. Sometimes I think people believe that God is simply waiting to strike out and bring judgment. Actually, it's the opposite. I think God is... Bible teaches, just based on what we read there, that God takes no delight in death of the wicked. I think I'm squealing a little bit. I'm going to drop that down there a little bit. God doesn't want to bring judgment upon mankind at all, but He will, because His word is true. And He tells us through His word, throughout His word, that there's penalties and repercussions for disobedience. And we know that, for instance, I thought Ronnie's going to talk about what I was going to, when he got up our talking man, he's going to start talking about what I'd studied on a little bit. But the Lord gave, in the situation of Moses and Pharaoh, the children of Israel, He gave the Pharaoh there chance after chance to cooperate when He spoke through His servant Moses, didn't He? He commanded him to release the Israelites from slavery. Instead, Pharaoh, he resisted and he continued to harden his heart, did he not? He, as a result, there was, I think, 10 plagues or judgments that came upon Egypt. Pharaoh was... finally worn down by them all. But throughout all those plagues there, he was always trying to mislead or deceive Moses through a series of compromises. But thankfully, Moses didn't succumb to any of those. But they're left one final judgment, which would be the death of Egypt's firstborn. And so some might see that. I know Ernie's been teaching in Joshua about some of the battles that Joshua had there. And we see what happened at Ai that Brother Ernie's been talking about, and how and how they slain all those all the people. But it's interesting that some people say that these kind of things are cruel or harsh or extreme on God's part. But I believe that for all practical purposes, all these situations, including this situation here with Pharaoh, he decided his own fate, didn't he? I think that Moses warned Pharaoh that he would be treated the exact same way that the Jewish people were. And so the Lord was very clear about what he said to Moses, because he said there in Exodus 4:22, if you want to turn there, if you're close to Exodus 4:22, he says, "And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, Thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn." So he was telling Pharaoh that Israel was his firstborn. And he said, "And I say unto thee, let my son go, that he may serve me. And if thou refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay thy son, even thy firstborn." So the Lord, I think, with all these plagues and all, and what he did with Pharaoh there, he was pretty gentle with Pharaoh in some ways, don't you think? He sent these plagues, each one gaining intensity as each one came. And so to try to get Pharaoh's attention. Does God not do that to us in a lot of ways? He sends things to us if we're not a believer. I know before I was a believer, he had to send things to me to get my attention. And thankfully, I did at some point. I didn't, but you can see here in Pharaoh that even though things kept intensifying with the plagues, Pharaoh's heart grew harder and harder. And so I think I read something where from a person one time that said that that Pharaoh, with what he was doing a little bit, it teaches us a good lesson about never to play chicken with God, because you're always going to lose. And I guess, in some ways, I think that that's true. So when God sent the final plague to Egypt, he gave God's people some instructions. He told them in Exodus 12:11, he said, "And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, and your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover." And 12:12 says, "For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord." And in 13 it says, "And the blood shall be for you a token upon the houses where ye are. And when you see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt." So, he was talking about in the beginning in verse 11, he talked about how they were to eat. So they were having their Passover meal before God sent the death angel through there. And he says, I was thinking about that, and I didn't think Rita was going to be here, but she showed up. Some people eat slowly. Others eat quickly. I'm not alluding to anything, but my wife, for example, she eats slowly, and she cuts her food, and she eats. It's almost like She eats perfectly, so she can have a conversation and all this kind of stuff, a nice conversation during the meal and everything. But my bites of food, on the other hand, are too big. I always felt like when, from the time, even when we first started dating, she'd always tell me, slow down eating, slow down eating. You know, because, and I always felt like the, to me, food tasted better the more I could get in my mouth. I'm kind of, that's kind of, that, but that's me. I mean, that's just kind of, that's kind of the way I am. And so I tend to, you know, I tend to eat my food with urgency. Why I do that, I don't know. But sometimes I just, most of the time I do. I feel like the faster I can eat, I can do something else or whatever. So the Israelites here, in this way, they were observing the Passover in Egypt, and they had to eat their meals with urgency as well. Why did they have to do that? Because God said they had to be ready to move at a moment's notice. The Passover for the Israelites was a new beginning for them. And the Lord gave them detailed instructions for something that they would do from that day forward. They were to remember what God had done for them, that He passed over them in His judgment upon Egypt because they did what they were told, didn't they? Are there things that God tells us? Are we supposed to do what we're told? I mean, God's not a taskmaster, but He calls us His children. So if we're His children, then we should be obedient to Him. We should do what we're told. I told Spencer that a whole lot. You need to do what you're told. sometimes it didn't work that way. So, and sometimes we get chastised, don't we? Because we don't do what we're told. So God said, He said, these are your instructions for eating this meal. You're to be fully dressed. You're to wear sandals. You're to carry your walking stick in your hand. You need to eat this meal with urgency, for this is the Lord's Passover. If God said, I'm going to pass over, I'm going to pass through Egypt this night, and God Himself was going to do this, and it didn't matter if you were, it didn't say that He was just going to do this to the Egyptians. He said He was going to do this through Egypt. So it didn't matter if you were an Egyptian or a Hebrew, the plague was coming through there, and it was coming for all that did not follow God's instructions. If you didn't follow God's instructions, you were going to die. So that is kind of the thing with us with Christ. I mean, we have to follow Christ's instructions, don't we? Christ laid out the plan of salvation. We need to follow that. If we're going to be saved, we have to go through what Christ told us how to be saved. And if we choose not to do that, then it's probably going to be on us, right? So I've got maybe one final thought about this is that, you know, in the beginning we talked about, you know, the judgment and that God, you know, in God's going to judge the world. He's going to judge humanity. But He don't want anyone to not be saved. Now, there will be people that won't be saved. We know that. But He wants all to be saved, all to come to repentance. And so Jesus Himself said in Matthew 10:28, He said, and fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear Him which is able to destroy the soul and body in hell. You know, all of mankind, including Pharaoh, has the same opportunity through the blood of Christ. In that case, through God's instructions during that time, during the Egyptian time, during the children of Israel's time, to accept God's conditions and be obedient to God's plan of salvation. And in the grace age, everyone has been exposed. Most people in the Western world anyway have been exposed to Christ. Now there's probably, I'm sure that there's other third world countries and maybe some places that at this point may not have had access to Christ, but we have a lot of good missionaries that are trying to get the gospel spread as best they can through these places that the gospel's not been preached. So, but everyone has the opportunity to receive the ultimate Passover that God's provided through the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And so, if we choose not to accept God's conditions and what God has laid out, we're like Pharaoh. We have nobody to blame but ourselves. And the folks out in the world that we need to be, as believers, we need to take heed to that, to the verse in Ezekiel, that and try to get the word out to folks as best we can to let them know that they have hope, and they have it through Jesus Christ. So as believers, we need to live with a sense of expectancy, or expecting the Lord's return. We need to be ready to go, just like the verse that the Israelites, with how they were to eat their food, and they needed to be ready to move. We're going to be moving one day, whether we move by death and the grave or we move by the rapture. One of these days, we're going to be leaving here, and it's going to be sooner than later for a lot of us. We don't know when our time is, but it's coming to all of us. But we need to be ready to go. Are we ready to go? Are we ready for opportunities to share the gospel to help others go with us? I mean, I would dare say that there's many, many people in our county that don't know the Lord. I know I run into people up there at Crusoe today that don't know the Lord. You know, they don't. I mean, you could tell by talking to them, and you give them a little bit as best you can and stuff. But in situations like that, you could meet a lot of needs up there by meeting people's physical needs and getting them saved. I know that there's a lot of churches up there. There's a lot of people up there helping those folks. And there'll be a lot of souls saved up there, I think, through this flood. And that's important. So we need to be ready. We need to be alert, because Christ could come in any moment. This is how we're to live in light of Christ's imminent return. And He is coming back. I know we've, in the day and hour that we live in, I've heard from the time I was little that, you know, Christ's coming back. Well, He is coming back. You know, He may not come in my lifetime. I don't know if He will or not. I would like to see it. It'd be something, wouldn't it? But if you don't, that's okay too. I'm still going. I'm still making the trip. I hope you are. That's all I've got tonight. Y'all have anything y'all want to, anything further y'all want to mention? I appreciate you. What?
Since you mentioned my eating habits.
Yeah.
I just came from Faith to hear an international missionary. And for anybody that's interested, this is a toothbrush that those folks over in Niger, for those missionaries, have served for over 20 years. This is what people brush their teeth with over there. Should
Steve.
We be thankful?
Steve.
I mean, how much more? And I saw pictures of people in their gardens using like tools that were used probably 100 years ago. And it just, you know, it just makes you realize what God's doing. We may not see it directly, but with our money that we give, and that offering plate comes around to help those missionaries to spread the gospel. We were talking about the folks at the Crusoe. There's one thing we can do. If we don't go physically, we can pray that the people that are working up there would meet those needs, and that those hearts would be changed. Because they told of these missionaries told of the story of a pastor who was he was Muslim, but he accepted the Lord and became a pastor. And so he was working with these two missionaries, and he wanted to build a school. So they said, and he wanted the missionaries to help him write the grants to be able to get the money. And of course, as missionaries, they can't ask the mission board for funds, but they said, we'll help you write the grant. But she said, the first thing we need to do is pray. And so they began to pray, And she went to the pastor because she said, we need to do this and go through the whole process, do the paperwork and everything. But she said, God's not going to give you the property to build that school. And he was like, well, why are we even going to, you know, what's the point in even going through the process if he's not going to give us the property? She said, I don't know, but this is just what he told me. So for weeks, they had to go to actually the president of Niger and meet with him. The missionaries didn't go, but he called this pastor, who he was communicating with because he wanted to buy the property. And he said every time he'd go to the palace, he'd call the missionaries and say, pray, I'm going to the palace. So he'd go to the palace, and the president would say, well, I want to sell you this property. He said, I'm going to hang on to it. And he said, you still don't have the money yet, but buy it. And he said, I want you to have it, but he said, I'm going to hang on to it. I promise I won't sell it to anybody else. And so this went on back and forth. So finally, he goes, he gets summoned to the palace, and the president has his cabinet around this huge oval table. And he said, well, you know, you still don't have the money. He said, I'm still working on it, you know, but you still don't have the money. And so he invited him to sit down, and he had all the other people, everybody except the pastor, the president, and his cabinet, he had everybody else to leave the room. Now remember, this is a Muslim country. They shut the door, and the president said, will you tell me about Jesus that you talk about in your Bible? That was the reason he was to follow through with that, was to be able to witness to those. Didn't get the property, but he was obedient. I'm just excited.
You never know. God works things out.
In his own time.
There's something good about what Paul did with Agrippa.
These instructions for these people was great, but they had to participate too.
Yeah.
They had to do their part. Mm-hmm. Because of that, there was redemption. Because of redemption, there's freedom coming.
Yeah.
And because after the freedom, there was sanctification coming. But, you know, it's good for us to have instructions, get instructions. Sometimes we got to do our part. We got to get in there and take part. If they hadn't put that blood on the doorpost, they had to kill that lamb first.
That's right.
And it'd been the right lamb. Put that blood on there, then the rest of it would have been null and void.
That's right.
But because of the obedience and their participation in doing their part, then God brought them through the spirit.
Christ took the blood on the doorpost for us, and all we have to do is just be obedient to what he asked us to do. Not a hard thing. It's just sometimes we're a little bit trifling, aren't we?
I want to thank you for that verse. I needed that there in Ezekiel. Strange how God's word speaks to you. I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. I've had a couple of rough weeks, a couple of weeks. You know, all this that's going on really tires me up. This ain't the same country I was raised in. It makes me mad. And usually what's in my heart is, there's a lot of people in Washington, D.C. or to get on their knees tonight, whether they know it or not, and thank God that he's God and I'm not. It just shows me the grace of God. Them people need to thank him that for that last breath he let them take. I'd have got rid of them a long time ago. They're drunk on power. There's a lot of people suffering tonight because of it.
Yeah.
He's a gracious God. We need to understand.
But he still loves them, don't he?
He loves them.
He takes no pleasure in them. He judges them. He wants them to be saved just the same.
Yes.
And all those people over in Afghanistan that's doing all the bad stuff, he wants them to be saved.
Yeah.
But
grace. You
know, yeah. It's a bad time for living in. I know that.
Because Woods told me Friday, I guess it was Saturday, said, you just think about God sitting up there looking down on everything that's happening in this world. If that was us, what would we do?
That's what
Lord
said. We'd be mad
if
we'd be doing
on a merciful God. Mm.
You know, it's easy to focus on the negative. It really is. But there's a lot of it. And Ronnie, I hear you with him looking down, but and I'm not saying it's just because they're my kids or whatever, but just to know also that he looks down and there's little blessings like these girls asking that for Amazing Grace to be something. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's still that little hope. There's always, like when you talked about, Greg talked about the 7,000 last week that he left for him and he thought he was the only one. Sometimes we feel like we're the only ones. You know, left, but there's others of us out there. And we just need to pray and that all those Christians bang together and that if each one of us just prays and each one of those prayers go up, you know, he hears those. And whether it's to save this country or turn it around or him come back, whatever his will is going to be, you know, I just ask that those prayers change that for us.
Yeah, there's still a remnant of the faithful few out there. We know that. A lot of stuff is going on in our world that's pretty grim right now, for sure. But there's always hope. Anyone else got a comment? Well, thank you for putting us with you. I appreciate that. So I'll stand, we'll be dismissed. Brother Mark, can you read the folks up now?
Father, we thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity to assemble together, Lord, and hear your word. We thank you, Lord, for what your word says to our hearts. Thank you for teaching. Thank you for being so good to us and being so merciful to us. Thank you for the grace that was shown toward me. Thank you for being a loving Heavenly Father. We pray that we'd always glorify thy name and lift you up. Help us to be that you'd have us to be, Father. Help us the rest of the week, Lord, bring us back on the Lord's Day. We do pray. Lord Jesus, we love you. Amen.
Amen.